Hello everyone, and welcome to the Maastricht Science Program Open Day broadcast. My name is Betty and I will be your guide today. I myself study here at the Maastricht University, however at a different faculty, therefore rest assured that most of the information mentioned today will be as new to you as it is to me. We are now here at the Maastricht Science Program faculty, and as you can see through the window behind me, the first visitors of the Open Day are already arriving. Our broadcast then consists of interviews with the academic staff, students, and as well as of videos that will show you more about the life here at the Maastricht Science Program. You can ask questions whenever throughout the program, and we will collect them and answer them by the end of the broadcast. But for now, just sit back, relax, have a cup of tea or a cup of coffee, and enjoy. Our first interviewee is Birgit Blum, who is a chemistry lecturer here at the Maastricht Science Program. Welcome to our broadcast,
Thank you.
Birgit.
Thank you.
So, to start a bit broadly, could you maybe tell us more about the Maastricht Science Program?
Well, the Maastricht Science Program is quite a new and very innovative program here in Maastricht. It is in the Faculty of Humanities and Sciences, and it's a very broad science program that leads to a bachelor's degree in the natural sciences.
Mm-hmm. You said it's innovative. What is so innovative about it?
Well, several things. Firstly, it's not a discipline-defined program that you'd have at most other universities. So our students can, for example, study a mix of chemistry, physics, biology, mathematics. We have interdisciplinary courses. Essentially, they can decide what they want to study, and they can have a mix of subjects, or they can just do one subject. Basically, anything is possible. And they are guided by academic advisors, and I think a colleague of mine will talk about that later. So it's innovative in the sense that the students can pick different courses. And, you know, for example, if a student comes here and is not sure what they want to study, then they can sort of do a bit of chemistry and mathematics, let's say, or biology and physics, and decide what they want to do after that. So I think that's very nice for young students.
And is it also innovative when it comes to teaching methods?
Definitely. I mean, Maastricht University is very well known for problem-based learning, and we implement that very strongly in our department. So problem-based learning is something very innovative. It's a student-centered phenomenon. So typically the students are in small groups of about 12 students, and they're confronted with a problem, and they solve that problem together in a seven-step process. Mm-hmm. So we do have traditional lectures as well to accompany this, but we believe strongly in a student-driven sort of teaching style, where the students really drive the teaching themselves using this problem-based learning approach.
And what do you mean by that, that they drive the teaching process by themselves?
Well, for example, they'll be confronted with a task or a problem, and then they have a discussion about that problem and do a brainstorming, and then they'll go home and sort of research the learning goals that they come up with during this brainstorming session. And the idea is that the academic staff member doesn't really sort of get too much involved, but that whole learning process is driven by the students. And I've been implementing this very strongly in my chemistry courses, and it really works very, very well, because rather than just having a unidirectional lecture where information is transmitted, they actually sort of do learning themselves. And it's also very good, by the way, for developing social skills and teamwork.
How many students are in a setting like this? Because I cannot imagine having 100 students interacting between each other and discussing a problem. So,
well, we have groups of up to about 12 students with one staff member that's there to sort of look that the process runs smoothly. So it's small groups, and so that's another huge advantage of our program, is that we really have an excellent staff-to-student ratio. So, as I said, we do have also traditional lectures in our program to accompany this problem-based learning. But the biggest class that I teach has about 60 students, which is the first year chemistry class. After that, classes are typically, you know, can be 10, 15 students, up to 20 students. So very small classes and individual attention, and then coupled with this problem-based learning.
Well, Maastricht University in general is regarded as one of the most international universities in Europe. How is the international setting look like at your faculty?
Well, we have really a very diverse student body with over 70 different nationalities. Mm-hmm. This makes for a very exciting and colorful and diverse student body, and I think this is really excellent for our students as well, because of course the world is becoming more, let's say, global, and I think we really have this global atmosphere here, mm-hmm. within our college. So it is set up like a college in the liberal arts and sciences tradition, and so it is a bit like a family, but a very, very colorful and international one.
Yeah, I can see that the global atmosphere is reflected by the map behind you.
Which is upside down.
This is upside down, so very nice.
Yes, we're actually in the student common room. So we have a space here in our building for the students to sort of meet up and have discussions and socialize. And so that's why we have the upside down map.
Could I ask a bit of a more personal question now? Like, what is your research at the moment, or what is your reach as a student that you're pursuing?
Well, I sort of believe very strongly in integrating research into teaching. I mm-hmm. think it's in line with the Humboldt philosophy. So, and I think even for undergraduate students, it's very important to be involved in some way in research. So currently, I have a couple of research projects running. And one of them is the development of anti-cancer agents. And I do this with the students, undergraduate students. And what's really rewarding is that here we, because of this very good staff-to-student ratio, our students can really do high-level research. And I've even managed to publish a paper or two with our undergraduate students. So I find that really great. And that's, of course, good for them going on to postgraduate studies.
So that's pretty nice. That means that students can really get involved in academic research already during their bachelor's.
That's right. And I think that is really a very, very good thing. In Maastricht, we have research-based learning, which is something a colleague of mine will talk about later, and projects. So we really have a very strong research theme here, mm-hmm. which is integrated into the education. So the students really, I think, from a very early stage, learn to do research and think like researchers.
So this research that you're talking about can be really done in any of the sciences that you offer, so biology, chemistry, or physics, right?
Right, and interdisciplinary as well. So we believe very strongly in sort of interdisciplinary ideas. Mm-hmm. I think that's also really a strong philosophy at Maastricht University. So breaking down these traditional discipline-defined boundaries and collaborating. And that's another thing that I find really exciting about working here is that I, for example, share an office with two biologists. And so the students really get exposed to all these mm-hmm. different disciplines here.
So could you, for instance, just state a few courses that are interdisciplinary at the faculty? Because
yes, well, we, for example, have courses in the neurosciences, mm-hmm. Which are somehow interdisciplinary, which the students can take. Courses in polymer chemistry, which involve polymer, simple chemistry and a bit of polymer physics, which is interdisciplinary. Nanomaterials, which is becoming, of course, a really important theme. Energy, sustainability. So we really have a range of interdisciplinary courses. But we also have discipline-defined courses. I think that's an important point. Mm-hmm. So say, for example, a student comes here and decides they want to just study chemistry, then that's also possible. And for example, last year I had a couple of students that did that. So you can either do a broad spectrum of courses, something interdisciplinary, or you can actually do a discipline-defined degree as well.
So is it really just up to the student what he or she will decide
absolutely,
to do?
Absolutely. It is really the student is sort of deciding what they want to mm-hmm. do. And as they move through the program, they change. They could change their mind and move in a different direction. And I think that's something that's really excellent, because typically at other universities, which are discipline defined, if a student after the second semester decides they no longer want to, let's say, study physics, mm-hmm. then they would have to switch to another program and start from scratch. Whereas here it's possible to actually just continue. So you can really move your way through the program and change as you grow and develop.
Well, And students, of course, get help, right, from the academic staff to choose the path, which is the academic advising.
Correct.
That we will talk about in a minute. And for now, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.
And good luck with the Open Day.
Thank you very much.
Hello and welcome back to the Maastricht Science Program Open Day broadcast. I am Betty and I'm here with our second interviewee, who is Erik Steen Bredeker. I'm very sorry for my pronunciation.
Okay. That's okay.
Who is a lecturer at synthetic biology here at Maastricht Science Program.
Yeah.
Welcome to our broadcast.
Thank you.
And he will tell us a bit more about academic advising. So could you just explain to us what academic advising is here at the Maastricht Science Program?
Yeah. So basically, like Birgit already told you, we have an open curriculum. So that means that students, when they enroll in our program, we offer basically a set of courses at different levels, and the students can basically build their own curriculum around their personal interests and their goals in the future. If they want to go to a master, a certain master, they can build their curriculum based on that particular master. Academic advising is basically, so as an academic advisor, we are basically the bridge between the students and the university. So we try to basically guide them in their choices they have to make to for their final goals. So since we have a lot of courses we offer, it's sometimes hard for the students to find their way into all those different offers we have in courses. Some of the students, they know exactly what they want to do in the future, but some of the students may have a vague idea what they want to do, but still want to find out what their interests are for the courses. Mm-hmm.
So how does this work? Like, how many academic advisors is there for a student? Or
Every student has one academic advisor, and we try to make a match between the students and the academic advisor. So we try to see if the student and the advisor have the same interests, maybe the same background, maybe the same personal skills, whatever. So we try to make a match between those two. And as an academic advisor, because we have many students, we have about, personally I have about 20 students I advise during their, their stay at the program. But every student has one dedicated academic advisor.
And what if students wants to, let's say, prepare for a master's degree? Is this also something that you discuss?
Yeah, this is something we would like to we discuss during during their stay here. So in the beginning we try to find out what their interests are, and we try to fit the different courses we offer to their interests.
And later on in the study, when they get an idea of what kind of master mm-hmm. they want to go to, then we try to fit the courses to that specific master so they can get into those masters later on without any problems and without any additional courses.
So and the academic advisor is the same for the student throughout the whole 3 years?
Yeah, normally that is the case. It is possible that a student that comes here starts with a very specific biology interest
mm-hmm.
and later on does some biochemistry or chemistry and thinks, well, maybe this is more what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And since we are a very interdisciplinary program, it's very easy to switch or to combine courses to get to a certain interdisciplinary field. And it can happen that some students which have an interest in biology switch to chemistry, which may not match the interest of or the knowledge of that specific academic advisor. That is a possibility. But we try to stick to the advisee, so the student mm-hmm. and the advisor, because you build kind of a relationship with those students over the time. So.
Yeah, I believe that's also very nice when taking into consideration that the faculty is very small scale, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess your relationship with the student is therefore...
Yeah, you see each other at regular times and you get to know
yeah.
each other and you, of course, see them in courses. And you know what they're up to and
mm-hmm.
how they do in the program. So you build a relationship and that's a nice thing.
And how often do the students meet with the academic advisors?
There is an official meeting twice a year,
mm-hmm.
so that means if they have to choose their courses for the next semester, there is a regular meeting in November and somewhere in May.
Mm-hmm.
So these are official, so they have to apply for it basically, and then
so it's like a mandatory
make an appointment,
yeah.
and it's a mandatory appointment. But it doesn't stop there. So
mm-hmm.
I regularly see my other student, all the students, all my advisees, during the year. So when I meet them in courses, I talk to them, and if they have any problems, my email is always open, so they can always mail me.
Yeah.
And I regularly have meetings outside the two mandatory.
So it's very nice to know the students can also turn to the advisor,
yeah,
not just
always,
based
always.
On them.
Because sometimes when they think about a certain master, they come to me with questions, so what should I do, is this a good master, what can I do in the future if
mm-hmm.
I have this master degree?
Yeah.
But also if they want to do a thesis abroad or a course abroad, then they come to me to get some advice about that topic.
Thank you very much for being here in our broadcast.
Yeah, welcome.
And right now we're gonna take a look at the video that will tell our audience more about the academic advising, and see you in a bit.
My name is Chris Pauling. I'm a lecturer in the science program in the topic of physics. And part of my job includes being the coordinator of academic advising in the science program, which means that I'm coordinating 20 advisors and 260 students in their advising process, ensuring that they can make informed choices about their curriculum, but also making sure that they have pastoral guidance and support while they're here in the university. The role of an academic advisor is really being the connection between the students and the university, in the sense that they, in an open curriculum, have to make informed choices about what they're studying here and how that will impact their future possibilities in terms of master programs, curriculum, and what makes a good coherent curriculum for them when they graduate. In their very first day at the science program, we give the students a questionnaire. We ask them to give us some indication about, well, what their academic aspirations are, what they're interested in, how certain they are about their studies, about different elements of the science program. And then we use that to assign somebody who has either a very similar subject area interest or somebody who we think will be a good match. Maybe they have similar personality traits, maybe they have a similar background. So a student might start in chemistry and then move maybe more into biology or into physics. it happens for all kinds of reasons. Where that happens, where the staff and the student no longer have a direct affinity, we really like to keep the relationship going between the advisor and the student, but it might be that for more subject-specific information, they have to go and find another source of advice. Or, of course, they come to my office where I have an overview of all the different areas and different people they can speak with, and so we use that as a way to ensure that people can still get good advice. Advising meetings have to take place 2 times per year, but in many cases take place many more times. The 20 or so staff members have a very close affinity with the program, so they see their students, their advisees a lot, just from virtue of being in and around the university, which means that there's a lot of informal advising moments, a 5-minute chat in the queue for lunch or while walking to the next class. Some students need more enhanced, let's say, advice, maybe in times of applying for master's programs, or if they're having some difficulties in the university, then we can set up more regular meetings. Some sessions take 5 minutes where we just sit down and we go, okay, are you finished here? Yeah, pretty much I'm finished. Tick, 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 sign the box to start the bachelor thesis, and the student leaves again. Sometimes the meetings can take even longer. Normally they're scheduled for 30 minutes, but well, just 5 minutes ago I had a meeting and I just rescheduled.
Thomas, Roy.
Hello everyone and welcome back to the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day broadcast. My name is Betty and I'm here with our third interviewee, who is Bart van Grinsven.
Yes, that's correct.
Again, apologize for my pronunciation, who is assistant professor here at the Maastricht Science Programme.
Correct.
Well, Maastricht Science Programme has laboratory facilities at the Brightlands Camelot campus, right? Which is approximately about 20 kilometers up north from Maastricht.
Yeah.
And don't worry, students do receive public transport there for free.
Yes,
so
they do.
That's a good thing. But could you tell us more about the Camelot campus?
Well, we are very spoiled. Since a year and a half, we've got a brand new building at the center of the Brightlands campus. We've got all the facilities to educate students in biology and chemistry and physics. And the building is located at the center, and we have close access to all the industrial sites around that. So the students get a feel of an industrial site. If they want to do projects with companies, then the leashes are very short. We've got all the equipment that we need to do research there. So it's a nice building, it's a nice environment, and I think this is an example of how it should be.
And what else is there at the campus? Is it just the research? It's just the university research?
No, it's not university research. So it started as an industrial site.
Mm-hmm.
The building, we share our building also with DSM and lots of other companies. Around the building are also other companies. It is a chemical site, but there are also a lot of startups that are in the interdisciplinary nature. Most of them are in the biomedical sector. Also some startup, spin-offs from Maastricht mm-hmm. University. So it's a mixture between academic research, but more the applied research and the short connection to the industry. And that is, I think, a unique selling point of the labs that we have.
That is very interesting. Like, I know that here at the Maastricht Science Program, you use research-based learning, right?
Yep.
Which is another educational system next to problem-based learning.
Yeah.
And is that what you apply at the Camelot campus?
Also, we highly believe in learning by doing. By submerging the students actually into research, we think that the students actually learn a bit more than just reading about science.
Mm-hmm.
About 40% of the curriculum is practical. So 40% of around 40% of their time they have to spend at the Camelot site. I incorporate students in my research. 50% of my appointment is teaching, with the other 50% is research. And I incorporate students into the research so they actually get a feel of what it is to do research, to write a publication, to get the results that you need. So to immerse them actually into research itself.
can students actually choose what kind of research they want to work on, or is it predetermined for them?
No, they can choose. So we have the project period twice a year, and they have a choice. So we advertise the projects that we have, and the students can choose for one of these projects. And then in groups of 6 to 8 people, they will be appointed to a project. And also for the thesis, they have the opportunity to choose different topics, of course.
As you said, there are also businesses in the campus. So can students interact with them?
Yes.
Therefore start breaking in something else than academia already during their bachelor's?
I think it's very important for students to also look outside the warm and comfortable room of the Maastricht Science Programme. So if you only stay within your own study for 4 years, for 3 years, then that's the only thing that you know. Well, if you are able to expand your horizon, to do an internship with a company, that's always an asset, also when you do a master or when you apply for a job later on.
Just a very short question to finish this. How often do students go to the Chemelot campus?
It's 40% of their time. So how often? During a period, normally they take 2 courses and a skill, and a skill is 1 full-time day a week.
By skill you mean going to the campus?
Yes, practical.
Perfect. Thank you very much for being here. Thank you for letting us interview you on this topic. And right now, let's watch a really short video on the Chemelot campus. Hello everyone, and welcome back to the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day broadcast. As our first interviewee Birgit already mentioned, Maastricht Science Programme is a very innovative programme. So the use of problem-based learning and research-based learning just speaks for themselves. Right now we're going to show you a short video about the implemented innovation into education in the Maastricht Science Programme. So enjoy, and after that we will have another interviewee about the project period.
Hi, I'm Donna and I teach physics here at the Maastricht Science Programme. Actually, I teach mostly maths and electronics as well, and I also work for EdLab, which is the university's department for education and innovation.
Hi, my name is Roy. I'm an evolutionary biologist here at the programme. I teach at Maastricht Science Programme plant biology, outdoor skills and other plant related topics.
Well, I think we teach in a really changing landscape these days, and it's important to always be evolving our teaching methods in light of like new technologies evolving as well.
Yeah, I completely agree. You need to make sure that you adapt to a changing world, and you need to adapt to what students know, and that's why we need to change. We cannot stick to the traditional style of teaching that was dominating universities for such a long time. For my own class, one of the things I like to do, I'm standing right now, but I also like to stand in my classes. In a traditional setting, students sit for a long time, the tutors sit for a long time, and when you sit, you start to rest a bit. and it's not really active in a classroom. And I like to have activity in my classroom because that's good for learning. And that's why I stand up with my students in class. I have them move around a lot. I have them write on whiteboards on the wall to come up with new ideas. And in this way, it becomes really energetic in class, and students like that a lot.
To prepare students for their final exam, I also create online assessments so that the students can test themselves throughout the course. So it's not a surprise when they reach the end of the course and they sit an exam and they find out how well they're doing right at the end of the course. They can also go online, they test themselves, they find out whether their answer is right or wrong, and that means that they can go away and either do more revision or find some help if it's necessary.
One of our other colleagues, Birgit, he has students make videos for other students, and that's a very powerful way of studying topics because you need to understand the topic really well if you want to make a video about it to help other students.
So one of my colleagues, Chris Portley, he allows the students to pick their own type of assessment when they take his course. So that's really different. Instead of saying, oh, you've got to submit an essay and you've got to sit an exam, he lets the students create their own form of assessment. So students have created a video that they've submitted, or they've even created a board game to explain some theoretical concept in physics. So that's really interesting. So in a traditional university where you go to your lectures, you're just listening to information being given to you all of the time. Then when it gets to the end and you have an exam, it can be difficult to remember all of that. Whereas actually, if you've had to create your own videos or you've had to teach somebody else, then you remember that material a lot better.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the hallmarks of the Mastery Science program, is that you need to be very active, not only in your classwork, but we also run four-week projects. And in these four-week projects, you need to do research. And in that way, you learn a lot about how research works, or you get new knowledge. And at the end, you have a thesis of one full semester, which is quite unique. And there also, you need to do very much or a lot of independent work. And you learn a lot about how this works, how to run a project, etc. So this activity, this research-based learning, and we try to also incorporate it in classes, that's really important for a program.
And that they're also really essential skills for the future, because you know, when you go out of the program, so you've got your bachelor's degree, you want to get a job, or you want to go on to a master's degree or a PhD, people don't just want people who can think and listen, people want you to be able to act on information and actually do the research and do the practical side. So in fact, in the research projects that we offer and in the theses, you also get the opportunity to work with companies. So you're getting real life experience and real life skills to help you for the future as well.
Welcome back to the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day Live Broadcast. My name is Betty and I'm here with our fifth interviewee, Linnea, who is a lecturer of biology, right? And a project coordinator of the project period.
Yes.
Here in Maastricht Science Programme. So to start with, what is a project period?
The project period happens twice a year during mm-hmm. our academic year, and we don't schedule any regular educational activities like lectures and PBLs and labs. But instead, we have 4 weeks of pure research. Mm-hmm. Students in a group of about 6 to 8 students have a research project, and they go all the way from coming up with a good question, designing an experiment, doing the experiment in the lab, and then analyzing the results and presenting it. So the whole loop of research mm-hmm. squeezed into 4 weeks.
And what is the reason for the project series to take place?
So the reason is because we're educating students to become researchers, mm-hmm. to become scientists. We think it's important that they experience what it's like to be a researcher, and you cannot really mimic that very well in the lab, because there's things like how do you work in a team? How do you deal with problems if your experiment is not mm-hmm. working? How do you solve those kind of things, and how do you eventually, in the correct way, present your data to people with different backgrounds? So we try to mimic that in those 4 weeks.
Mm-hmm. And so, but does the project period always happen at the same time of the year?
Yes, so they happen in January and in June. Mm-hmm. So those 2 months are pure research.
And what about the kinds of projects that students can work with? Are they like on a different levels of difficulty, or?
Yes, so we start out with 1,000 level projects. That's what you do in your first year, and then you go up to 2,000 or 3,000 level, and you have increased difficulty, but also increased responsibility as a student. So there's a supervisor, but there's less and less guidance, mm-hmm. and more responsibility for the student, which each level that they go up.
I'm sorry, you said 1,000, 2,000 level. What does that mean?
That's basically the codes that we have for mm-hmm. our projects and for our courses as well. So levels of difficulties.
And can students also work with companies on this, or is it just the university based?
We have two like extra flavors of projects, so to speak. So we have the possibility for students to come up with their own projects.
Mm-hmm.
They can submit a proposal, and if it gets if enough students sign up for it, they can do that experiment themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have company projects. So a project that we offer, for instance, with the Natural History Museum in Maastricht,
mm-hmm.
The University Hospital, also with Gaia Zoo, we have a project, and several companies at Camelot as well. So there's also the possibility for students to do research, but outside of a university setting.
Okay, so where does the research take place? Is it then based on the project itself?
So it can be loads of different places.
Mm-hmm.
So if a project is initiated by a student or by one of our,
mm-hmm.
our faculty, it's usually at the Camelot Labs. If it's initiated by a company, then it's often at the company or at Gaia Zoo, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on the project. There's also projects that take place outside. They're field projects, so
mm-hmm.
to speak, in biology.
Projects.
Field work, like you collect plants or collect beetles, those kind of things. Yes, so very varied. There's a lot of different types of projects available.
Well, thank you very much for you being here and telling us more. And now we will look at a video that was filmed by Maastricht Science Program students during their four weeks project when they were working on, spectrography. And enjoy. Camelot is really exciting, except for the times when things go bad. But of course, you have a group to work with, and you have people double-checking your work, and you work together to solve the problem. So it always ends up good in the end. One of those times of the year where even though everything goes in all directions for 3 weeks, at the end, if you get the right results, it actually feels like you're doing something for a reason, and that's the coolest thing. Hello, welcome back to our broadcast. I'm Betty and I'm here with John Sloggett, who is a lecturer of biology and a project manager of thesis project manager, is that right?
Yes.
Here at the Maastricht Science Program.
Yes.
Thank you for being here. First of all, let's start a bit broadly. What is bachelor thesis research?
Right, well, the students do 5 semesters of normal courses, skills, projects. After that time, they have one semester, which is the last semester before they graduate, when they devote the entire semester to research. That's the bachelor thesis. Basically, it's a summarising of everything that they've done up to that point. So they get to show all the skills, all the stuff they've learnt in that piece of research. Mm-hmm. So they start it from the beginning, they plan it, they develop it themselves, they work in the lab on it, and then they write a report and they give a presentation on it. Mm-hmm. And that's unlike the projects that Linnea was just talking about. There are students working in groups, but mm-hmm. here the student is working on their own, so they're showing individually what they have learnt while mm-hmm. they've been at the MSP. So it's sort of like a final sort of like summary of everything that they do.
Yeah, you said they give a presentation of their research. Mm-hmm. That means they need to defend their thesis?
Yes, so they defend their thesis in the same way that maybe a master's student or even a mm-hmm. PhD student would. So they have an audience of their peers, also of staff, maybe their research supervisor as well, but mm-hmm. we'll come back to that. And they stand up, they give a presentation, they're then asked lots of questions about their work, and they have to show mm-hmm. that they really understand what they're doing.
You said a research supervisor. So can a student choose the research supervisor?
Yes, the students do choose the research mm-hmm. supervisor. They will choose what to do in their bachelor thesis based on their own scientific mm-hmm. interests. And they will go out and find their own research supervisor, somebody who's doing research in an area that they find interesting, mm-hmm. To go and work with. And that can be in the science program, outside of the science program, in the wider university here. It can be elsewhere in the Netherlands. It can be abroad. We have students working in South America, doing things on coral reefs, for example.
Yeah, this actually leads to another question. So that means that the student does not need to really stay here at the university?
No, they don't. No, we encourage them to go out and to experience the wider world. The MSP, it's quite a small community. It's a nice place to study in, mm-hmm. But at the same time, there's a bigger world out there. There are big research groups out there, and you want the students to actually experience this wider research environment. So it's also an opportunity to network and get to know mm-hmm. other people in the field that you're interested in.
Does the university help the students to go out to approach other places for the thesis, or is it just up to their own?
Well, we have a lot of staff here, a lot mm-hmm. of international staff, so not just staff who have been based in the Netherlands. A lot of our staff have many research connections in other places, mm-hmm. in other countries even. And so the students can exploit the staff networks as a way of finding mm-hmm. Somebody to do a bachelor thesis with. If they're doing it within the university, they can talk to course coordinators and that sort of thing as a way of finding somebody. Or they can just sort of like go out free and try themselves to see what they can find. And we can give them advice on how to make contact with research mm-hmm. groups and how to try and find exactly what it is that they're looking for.
So in the end, this is like the end of the whole study.
Yes, this is the final thing. This is sort of like the grand finale mm-hmm. That provides a sort of like a final sort of like summing up of all the capabilities, things that they've learned at the MSP, allows them to specialise in the areas that they're most interested in. It provides a very good starting point mm-hmm. for when they go on to do a master's, for example. Mm-hmm. Because it means that they already go out with considerable research experience in the wider academic environment. And that's a good thing when you go into a master's if you've already had that experience.
Well, thank you very much for being here and for answering my questions. I hope they're valuable for our audience. And right now, let's take a look at another video. My bad. Now we will mute our microphones for a bit because we need to change them because now we're going to have two students here and we will talk about the studies from their perspective. So please stay with us. We'll be right back. Hello everyone and welcome back to our Maastricht Science Program Open Day Live Broadcast. I'm Betty and right now I'm here with two Maastricht Science Program students, so we can hear actually something about the students' perspective of the studies. I'm here with Matthew, who is from Singapore, and Clara, who is from Germany. Welcome.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, tell me a bit about why you chose the Maastricht Science Program.
I think I chose it mainly because it's a very small scale program, mm-hmm. so it's more personal than if you sit in a big lecture hall with hundreds of students and you're just a number in the system. And here it's really personal and I really like that approach.
For you?
In MSP, what's really nice or why I chose it is you actually have a lot of opportunity to do more than just the normal sciences. Mm-hmm. So I'm focusing more on bio, but there's also a chance if I don't want to do bio, I can do some physics or chemistry along with that. So yeah, it's really nice.
What would you say so far you've enjoyed the most in the program?
I think I don't know if there's one thing that I really enjoyed, but I really enjoy it when, I really enjoy the community and that it's so international. So you sit in a tutorial group and everyone is from a different country. It's just very special and unique.
Yeah, like Clara said, MSP, it's a really international school. Mm-hmm. I think it might be one of the more... It's more personal as well in just things that you do with the different lectures that you have. And MSP is like a really big family, so you don't feel, I guess, like that stress as a student mm-hmm. anymore. So just speaking to your tutors, your lecturers is really casual. So it's mm-hmm. nice, actually.
Yeah. It's one of my favorite things. If you have questions, you can always drop by your professor's office and they will always be here for you if you have questions.
Well, we've previously in the broadcast talked about the project period. So could you maybe tell us more about the projects you've done already in the program?
Projects that I did, I was working with John. What we did was we were looking if male ladybugs, the older male ladybugs, would mate more than younger male ladybugs just because they were about to die. So what we wanted to do was actually kind of focus and see if that was actually a true reason or maybe the younger ones would mate more. So that's one of the projects that I did.
Yeah, one of the projects that I did 1 year ago was a ruthenium project where we made a ruthenium complex which can be used for anti-cancer applications. So it has anti-cancer properties and we basically we synthesized that project that molecule and we characterized it and then we sent it to South Africa mm-hmm. where it was tested for their anti-cancer activity and that was really interesting.
Well, you're both coming from abroad, so what would you say about the life here in Maastricht and actually a foreign city for you?
Yeah, I think Maastricht's a really small city, mm-hmm. so I mean, coming from Singapore, I'm used to the hustle and bustle of just city life. So in Maastricht, you do have that that kind of hustle and bustle, but the thing is, it's so small, and just walking down the street, you'll bump into people that you know, whether it's from MSP or from outside. So it's really nice, actually.
Yeah, I'm actually from a small city as well, so it's not that different for me. But I really like the fact that you can just cycle everywhere and you're close to everything. You're close to the university, you're close to all your friends and close to, just everything you can do.
And anything specific about the student life here? Like how you feel as a student in the city?
I think we have a lot of different opportunities to either you want to play sports or if you want to join an association. So for me, I play rugby and it's really nice actually having that, I guess, that output or somewhere that you can actually go to mm-hmm. Try something new. So it's always nice to be able to do that.
Yeah, we have this university sports center mm-hmm. that offers any sports that you can think of, like horseback riding, fencing, everything. And it's really fun to go there and try things out and been doing that a lot.
So therefore, even though it's such a small city, or it really depends where you come from, but it's not the biggest city in the world, you can still be pretty active here, right?
Yeah, I think it's mainly because it's a student city, so there are lots of activities offered for students.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for being here and for answering my questions. Is there any last sentence you'd like to tell to our prospective students watching?
You should all come here.
So since we already started with the topic of student life, we're now going to show you a video about the student life. So stay put and enjoy.
Is heavy with the thought of you. The moment I awake, I'm chasing signs. Never give up, I never give up. It's never enough, it's never enough. You're not the one. Scared that the sun won't shine on me. I've been holding on for some time. Begin.
Hello everyone and welcome to the Maastricht Science Program Open Day broadcast. So far we've talked about how it is to study here, how do the studies look like, but we haven't touched upon probably the most important questions for you now, and that is the admission process. Therefore, I'm here now with the admission officer, Nicole Felix.
Good morning.
It's good to have you here.
Thank you.
And could you maybe tell our audience a bit more about for whom is the program suitable?
Mm-hmm. We have students with a passion for science. That's one of the most important things, mm-hmm. of course. Then students have a good knowledge of chemistry and or biology and or physics, and they have to have good knowledge of mathematics, mm-hmm. Especially calculus. Then our students likes to work in groups. We have more than 70 nationalities, so that means that a student has to feel comfortable in an international group of students. Mm-hmm. And then last but not least, our program is taught in English, mm-hmm. so it's very important that the knowledge of English is good.
Is there any requirement for an English language certificate for the
yes.
applicant?
Yes, for the English certificates, it's possible to do an IELTS or a TOEFL, mm-hmm. or a Cambridge certificate.
So that is a CAE?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And could you maybe describe the whole admission procedure a bit closer?
Mm-hmm. There is a Dutch website which is called studielink.nl, mm-hmm. and all students can register via Studielink, choose Maastricht Science Program, And after that, they will get an email with a login code to MyUN, and they are requested to upload some documents, such as grade list, diploma, and the motivation letter, of course. After that, our Board of Admissions will decide if there will be an interview that can be in person or via Skype. And after the interview, it will be decided if the student is a good match with Maastricht Science Program.
Do you think students should be, I presume most of the students will be a bit worried about the interview. So is it with the academic staff member or who does the interview?
Yes, one academic staff member and one admissions officer.
So it's with
two persons,
but one interview.
Yes, it's one interview, yes.
And what are the intake moments at the Maastricht Science Programme?
They can register for the September entry already. And the intake moments are all the time. When we have the files complete, there will be interviews all the time. So, but there is a deadline. And one is the 1st of May. That's for Dutch and European students. And for non-European students, it's the 1st of April.
Okay, well, when can the students start actually studying here? So is it September only, or can they start a program at a different point of the academic
year?
They
can start in September. There is 1 week before there is an introduction week. And they also can start in February. We have two start dates per year.
But if it's... For some students, it might seem a bit odd to start in February because in most of the countries it's only September. So, does the academic year look the same for the for students who start in February?
It's exactly the same. Yes. Also, 3 years full time. You start with the core, so everything is the same.
So therefore, then they graduate in February in 3 years.
In 3 years, yes.
So they don't need to be worried about missing anything
no,
now.
No, not at all. No.
And what would you say is the is there a big difference between the amount of students who start in September and in February, or is it more or less the same?
Yes, February is usually a small group, and September, of course, is the biggest group per year. So that's approximately 120 to 150 students, and in February is usually 30.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your time and for answering my questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being here. And the Maastricht Science Programme only started in September 2011. Therefore, so far, there have only been 3 years of graduates, and only recently there was an alumni conference from the Maastricht Science Programme. Now we're going to show you a video from this conference, and after that we will come back here and have a bit more chat with the students and with Matthew, who will tell us more about how the open day is actually going on, since we haven't really received that many questions for you, because apparently we're pretty clear on what we're saying. So, enjoy the video and see you soon.
Let's go to a great demonstration that once you're MSP, you're always MSP. And when you graduate, you never leave the MSP behind. Because the MSP community is always so beautiful, so harmonious.
You have to learn something, you know, you always learn to harness the wonderful things about the university.
And to see the program developing in such a positive way is amazing.
Your background is to sell it.
We're going to be the people that think out of the box. And that's extremely beneficial in research, because you're going to see professors going to just highlight their eyes and just thinking, wow, you're really clever.
Yeah, I mean, alumni conference is the best. I think, you know, like, today it was very well organized.
First of all, the project periods were great because we were able to, like, design our own projects as well. And that kind of freedom, especially as an undergrad, is, like, rare.
Yeah,
like,
definitely.
Very,
the kind of independence.
Have that, and that, the trust and independence that the staff gives you here is great.
That's what I want. I want people to say MSP is where you gotta be.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Hey Hello and welcome back to the Maastricht Science Programme Open Day broadcast. Right now I'm here again with our first interviewee, Birgit. Hello again. And with Matthew, a current student of the Maastricht Science Programme. So how is the Open Day going so far for you?
It's going pretty well. Meeting up with a few parents and students that are just asking questions on the curriculum in the school. For me it was more based on bio. Asking me about what the courses are like, what are the different choices that the students have.
Yes, I think it's starting to pick up now. We're starting some parallel sessions. We have a nice research-based learning exercise in chemistry, which I'm going to be running with a colleague of mine. And we're going to do some chromatographic separation of some ion complexes, which is quite exciting. And we also have a science fair going on here and lots of information about the research that we're doing, the program, and also a PBL session on being an Olympic sport star. So that's also running. So we have these parallel sessions through the day.
So does that mean that prospective students can actually try out how it feels like to be a part of PBL session?
Right. So we have that. And also we're doing an experiment. So and there's lots of information sessions as well about the curriculum and the program itself through the day, being repeated at various time intervals.
Are these sessions also for the parents, or is it just the prospective students?
It's for both. We find it very important to inform the parents as well, because they're obviously part of making the decision. So we tend to interact with both the parents and the students.
Very nice. A question for you, Matthew, since you're actually working here, right, at the Open Day.
Yes.
So does that mean that as a student you get an opportunity to really get involved with the university on a work relation as well?
Yeah, we actually have this thing, it's called a promo team.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm part of the promo team, and what we do is actually we work with the school affairs, and what we do is we go to different high schools, or we do open days and intro days.
Mm-hmm.
To work with the new students and kind of sell them into Maastricht, and also just give them a chance to see what MSP or like how we study, how student life is really like. Yeah,
that's very nice. So the university also offers you the opportunity to make some money on the side, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, is there anything you would like to tell to our audience, to our prospective students, as a last message?
Well, I would say if you're in the area of Maastricht, I would highly encourage you to come here. It's very exciting. We have lots of coffee and cake available. Really to come and experience the vibe here, which is, I think, very unique.
Yeah. Matthew, I already asked you in the previous interview.
Yeah, it hasn't changed.
All right. Well, if I can speak from my own experience, even though I don't study at this faculty, I have to say student life is Maastricht, and the whole vibe and feeling is really something you will never forget, and that, trust me, that's true. Well, anyways, I very much thank you for spending an hour with us, and I hope you enjoyed our broadcast. You got all the information that you need. In case you didn't, just check the official Maastricht University website and contact us anytime you really want. So thank you, and enjoy the rest of your day, I guess.